Hello everyone, my name is Chen Peng. I'm from Intel company and working on Zephyr OS testing and development. I have been working on Zephyr about 3 years. I'm very glad to have this chance to give a sharing about this. Okay, let us get started. Today my topic is about the dynamic module loading. I will mainly introduce from three aspects. The first is the requirement of the dynamic module loading. What does it need to do? Second is the usage, what it can be used for. The last one is I will give a brief proposal about how to enable this feature in our Zephyr OS. What is the dynamic module loading and what does it need to do? For dynamic module loading, it should support to load a library at the runtime, and it couldn't impact the running of the main application. After loading the library into the memory, it should support to execute those functions or access those variables which are defined in the loaded library. Also, after we finish our function, if we don't need this library, we should support to unload it from the memory at the runtime too. And what is the dynamic module loading used for? This feature could be used to expand the functionality of the main application. For example, we can use this feature to install plugin. After we loading a plugin into the memory, we can invoke those functions defined in plugin to expand the functionality of the main application. Also, this feature could be used to select the optional module. For example, if we have a application used to decode and encode the audio, but there are many different forms of the audio. We can compare all of them into the main application at one time. This will waste lots of memory. After we enable in this feature, we can load the specific audio format codec. And then, if we don't need it, we can unload it to release the memory. The second one is, this feature could be used to achieve the OTA over the air update. Because after enable this feature, we can separate our main application from different modules. If we want to update one single module, we can just change the module code and recompile this module and flash it into the memory. We don't need to recompile the whole code. Okay, before we go into the details of the dynamic module loading process, I want to give a brief introduction about the compile and link. Because for dynamic module loading, it will use the link process to achieve its function. This picture shows the workflow from the source code to generate the final executable program file. It mainly includes two steps. One is the compile, one is the link. Compile is used to convert the source code written by C language into the object file. This is the machine code. And the other step is the link process. It will compile one or more object file as the input, include the program object file, static library or shared library to generate the one output the executable program file. For dynamic module loading, as I just mentioned, it will based on the link process. So I will give more details about the link process. Link process, this is used to compile one or more object files into a single executable file, library file, or other object file. For example, it may implement the program static lib library or shared library, and then output is one program. This program may be an executable or library or other object file. For link process, it mainly includes two steps. One is the address and the memory allocation. This step is used to allocate a memory space and then copy the necessary contents from those included object file into the memory. The second step is the simple relocation. This is the most important process during the link. It mainly used to decide the final address of those undefined symbols in the code. For example, if we in the program code we use some function which are defined in the lib1, but when we compile the program object file, we don't know the function address at all. It is undefined. So after we loading the program into the memory, we should modify those functions address. For linking, there are two types of link. One is the static linking. This will link all object files at compile time before loading. It will make a copy of all input object file into the final output. For example, when we generate the program one, if it used the lib of it will include the lib object file into the output. And if we when we generate the program two, it also will include the lib object file into the output. Thus, make a result is when we execute the program one, and the program one object and lib object file will be copied into the memory. When we start to execute the program two, the lib object file will be copied into the memory again. This will waste a lot of memory space. The another disadvantage is that static linking is hard to update the module. For example, if we want to update the function in lib after we change the lib code, and we need to recompile the whole program too, we can't adjust it because lib and the program two, they are compiled into the program two output. We need to recompile the whole code. So in order to fix the memory wasting and the hard module update program in static linking, there is another dynamic linking. This will postpone the link process to runtime after loading. For example, when we need to execute the program one, we will load the program one into the memory. But we found that the program one, it depends on the lib object file because it will use some function or variables defined in lib. Then it will find this lib object file and load it into memory. Then program one could be executed successfully. When we need to execute program two, we will load this program two into memory. But we found that this lib object file is already exceeded in the memory. We don't need to load it again. Then this lib object file could be shared by those two program files. It won't waste the memory. Actually, for dynamic linking process, it mainly includes the four steps. The first step is load the main application into the memory, and then it will find the dependency library and load all of them into the memory. After the loading, they will do the simple relocation to resolve those all undefined simple address. And then it will give the control to the program and it will start as quickly. It will start as quickly. And all of this is based on the a dynamic linker provided by OS. In Linux, it is this file, ld.so. This file will finish all of these four steps. And for dynamic loading, actually, it is based on the dynamic linking. The difference is that for dynamic linking, the library loading and simple replication are done by the OS dynamic linker. But for dynamic loading, this will be triggered by the application. But it requires OS to provide a dynamic loading API to achieve the same function with the dynamic linker. Then the application could invoke this API to load any necessary libraries. Like the DL API in Linux, this API provides four functions. DL open, this function is used to open a shared object file and load it into the memory and do the simple replication. If we want to invoke the functions in the library, we need to invoke this DL simple function. We can pass the function name to this function, then it will return an address. Then we can according to this address to invoke the function which defined in that library. DL error, this is used to check errors. DL close is used to unload the library from memory. Okay, from this slide, I will give my brief proposal about how to implement this dynamic modding loading feature in Zephyr OS. According to our lessons before, we need to provide a dynamic loading API which achieves the same function as the dynamic linking. So we can provide a IF loader because in Linux the object file is using the IF format. So we mainly focus on the IF format. It mainly includes three steps. The first step is the IF parent. We need to parent input the object file according to the IF format to get all necessary contents. And then the second step is the memory allocation. We should allocate a memory space and load the app and load the parent and load the necessary contents into the memory just to do a copy operation. The last step is the simple replication. This is the most important step. For app parenting, there is an app spec to describe the app format. For app file, there are two different view. One is the linker view. This is mainly focused on the section. You can see that there are app header, section one, section two, and a section table. We can, according to the section offer and send, to get each section account from the file. This view is mainly used for the static linking. The second view is the action view. It mainly focuses on the program header and the segment. And this view is mainly used for dynamic linking. And this is what we need to parse and get all necessary contents. And the difference with the link view is that it have done the map between the section to segment. It will put the sections with the same x-axis into one same segment. We can parent the program header to get our necessary contents. Actually, all segments with the PD node type should be copied into memory. So we can iterate the program header to get all segment with this node type. We can according to the offset and the memory size to get each segment contents. After we getting necessary contents from the app file, we need to load them into the memory. Then we need to allocate the memory space and copy them. Currently, there is a problem that, for example, it only supports to allocate a continuous virtual space for platforms with MMU, some x86 platform and ARM platform. Without MMU, how do we allocate a continuous memory for module loading? My current purpose is that we can reserve memory in advance. When Zephyr boots up, we can use this memory to load the module. For example, we can define a static memory help before using a configure to set our expected size. Then, when we want to load a module, we can allocate a memory space from the memory help to load our module. Simple relocation. For example, it supports many architectures, including x86, ARM, ARC architecture, and so on. For different architectures, they have a lot of very different relocation types. It is difficult to cover all. So, in order to simplify the simple relocation process, we can use the GOT only relocation type. What is the GOT OT relocation? I will introduce in this slide. But there are some preconditions. When we compile the module object files, we need to add some compiler flag like shared PIC and OPLT. Shared, this flag is used to generate the shared object file, which is used to support for dynamic linking. PIC, this is used to generate position independent code. This is mainly used for sharing the library between multiple processes. OPLT, this is used to disable the PLT procedural linkage able table. This table is mainly used to access those external functions defined in other modules and do the lazy binding. But in order to simplify the relocation, we can disable this PLT table. Then no matter whether the variables or functions, they will all do the relocation via the GOT table. GOT table is a global offset table. This table is used to find those simple address which are defined in other modules. This is a GOT relocation table example. For example, if we have a module the code as below, we define a function foo. It will it access a variable b which are defined in other module and invoke a function bar which was defined in other module. So when we compile this module, we don't know the address of the variable b and the function bar. It is undefined. So after we loading this module into the memory space, and if we want to access, for example, if we want to access the function bar, first thing it will go to the GOT table. In this GOT table, it will save the absolute address of the function bar. It is from other modules defined in located at this address. I have submitted a PR to enable this feature in Zephyr before, but it is still working in progress. The PR link is here. If you are interested, any comments or suggestions are welcome. Thanks. Okay, that's all. Thanks.